there's a quote from Jens Carstensen in one of his books on stability, and I really think it's a good quote to start framing the discussion around stability. We want to accelerate decomposition in a meaningful way because we don't want to wait 3 years to find out what's going to happen in 3 years. And it's not always that easy. Let's talk about some definitions from ICH Q&A, and now it's in R2 second revision. And they define stress testing, and I like this term, intrinsic stability of the molecule. So stress testing is designed to uncover the intrinsic stability to establish the degradation pathways. And so when we do stress testing, the idea is to help you begin to understand the chemistry, the degradation chemistry of your compound, and what could happen. It's, you know, like, what are the available pathways that can be triggered under pharmaceutically relevant conditions? Then accelerated stability testing, that's a more defined by ICH. That's part of the formal study. So that's a 40, 75, or a 15 degrees C above your long-term storage condition. It's supposed to be an exaggerated storage condition, and it's supposed to give you some idea of what really will happen. Accelerated stability and long-term stability are really part of formal stability studies, whereas stress testing is an investigation. And you don't have any quality standards when you start out with stress testing. You might, but if you're starting with a new compound, you have no quality standard. So you have to develop it. It's a chicken and an egg process. Another definition, more detail, is also contained in Q&A when it talks about the specific conditions. So humidity, oxidation, photolysis, photostability, and it talks about the effect of temperatures in 10 degree increments. I don't know many people who do 10 degree increments. Typically they do a high temperature that's above accelerated stress. Occasionally you can do 10 degree increments and try to develop some Arrhenius relationships, but I'm not going to talk too much about that today. So the reason I'm not going to talk about it, because I want to talk about the two critical parameters that are useful for predicting what degradation products are going to occur. One, you have to predict the degradation profile. That is, what are the compounds that could form from the available pathways to that particular molecule? So you need to develop an understanding of that. The other is predicting the rate, and a lot of people, you need to keep these separate in your mind. They're two different things. The predicting the degradation profile, which is founded on stress testing or forced degradation studies, is what is needed. That's the foundation from which you can then do your ASAP prediction, so that you can get kinetics detail and information once you have this understanding, because it's the degradation profile from which you develop your stability indicating method. So this definition from FDA, because some people say, well, the ICH guidelines never really define stability indicating method. And so here's, you can find one. This is at FDA, and this has been documented in a few literature examples. But the stability indicating assay accurately measures the API and or APIs without interference from the degradation products, process, and purity. So without interference. And it says that it may be demonstrated by performing stress testing studies or forced degradation, and it describes a little bit about the conditions, and it says that the stress testing study should demonstrate that the impurities and degradation products do not interfere with the quantitation, so they need to be resolved in your method from the parent. And if you're thinking HPLC, you're thinking separation, you're thinking resolution. If you're thinking some kind of titration or some other method, it would just be they need to not interfere.